Hello viewers, today I am going to take you through shoulder examination as how to examine a shoulder properly. I would like to pass on my gratitude to Mr. Bibul Patel who taught me whatever shoulder I know today. People find shoulder examination very difficult and same was true for me when I was training in my initial years. However, after working with Mr. Patel and working in some other shoulder firms, I realize it is one of the easiest areas of the body to examine. I'm pretty sure that after watching this video, you will have better understanding of shoulder pathology, and I'm confident that you will be able to make shoulder diagnosis very easily. Whenever examining a patient in a shoulder clinic, as soon as patient walks into the clinic, you can have some idea about what this patient may be suffering. Say for example, if you have a young male or a female who is less than 20 years of age, then straight away you should think about instability in your mind. Similarly, if you know your patient is between 20 to 40 years of age, then there is a very good chance that this patient may be suffering from supraspinatus impingement. If somebody is from 40 to 60, he may be suffering from impingement. He may also be suffering from cuff pathology, probably partial or a full thickness cuff tear. And as patients get older, especially after 60 or 70, you are thinking of arthritis, whether it's a straightforward arthritis due to wear and tear, or it may be arthritis due to rotator cuff pathology. So age is an important giveaway when the patient comes to you in a shoulder clinic. So as told before, a particular age can give you a good idea about what is the most likely diagnosis. So in this video, I am going to cover how to examine somebody if he has got instability. We will also talk about impingement. I will also show you how to examine rotator cuff. We will also cover ACJ or acromioclavicular joint arthritis. We will cover biceps. We will also cover slap lesion, and as well as we will cover frozen shoulder. So these are the most common diagnoses that you will see in a patient with a shoulder pathology. So I will try to cover the 6 or 7 entities, and I'm pretty confident that after watching this video, you will be able to diagnose them easily. So examination of the shoulder always starts with examination of the neck. So always keep in mind that if somebody is presenting you with a shoulder pathology, it could be a referred pain from a cervical spine problem. So always start with cervical spine first. I think the three important questions if you're taking a history in the shoulder patient is, first, where is the pain? Whether pain is on the side of the shoulder or pain is on the top of the shoulder. The side of the shoulder pain is usually due to rotator cuff pathology, whether it is impingement or cuff tear. Top of the shoulder is usually related to acromioclavicular joint problem. Whether the patient can sleep on the side or not. If the patient is not able to sleep on the side, chances are the patient most likely has a cuff pathology. So pain is one important question that you need to ask: where is the pain? Now the second important thing that you ask in shoulder patient is whether there is associated loss of movement or not. So most of the patients with shoulder pathology will have some difficulty or some loss of movement, like reaching in the back, reaching on the top, reaching on the side. So especially for females, if they are trying to wear the undergarments, they do struggle. So loss of movement is also a very important question that you need to ask. And third is weakness. If somebody is experiencing weakness in the hand, that means the disease is advanced, or it could be related to cuff tear or due to muscle weakness. So the three questions that you need to ask in shoulder patient is pain, whether there is any loss of movement, and whether there is any associated weakness in the upper limb. So as said in my introduction, I said I always start my examination with an examination of the cervical spine. So always check the movement of the cervical spine and have a feel if patient is having any pain. So Akash, can you just do this? Upar. So his range of movement is pretty good. And I will also feel for any pain. So if patient is having any pain, then it may be related with C-spine, or if there's any loss of movement. So do a rough screening of C-spine before you move on to the shoulder. So first, let's start with the looking from the front. So when I'm looking from the front, I'm looking whether the head is in the center. So head is bang in the center, that tells the patient has got a good coronal balance. I'm also looking whether both the shoulders are at the same level or not. And both the shoulders on this occasion are looking pretty good. Then we should focus on the muscles. So these are trapezius, any obvious wasting or any obvious asymmetry. Then we have pectorals, then we have what? Deltoid contour, and of course biceps and the forearm muscles. So if there is any pathology, say for example somebody has got frozen shoulder or somebody has got injury to axillary nerve, you will see that the deltoid bulk is less. Or if somebody has got frozen shoulder and is not able to use the muscles, you will start noticing any obvious wasting. So again, looking from the side, it is extremely important to check the sagittal balance. So sagittal balance is location of the head in relation to its body. So head is bang on the center. So the sagittal balance on this occasion is extremely good. If somebody has got any cervical pathology, then there may be a poor sagittal balance or pathology somewhere else in the spine. We also look at the trapezius, we look from the deltoid from the side, we can look at biceps, triceps, and to some extent supraspinatus and infraspinatus fossa. So you look from both the sides and look for any obvious asymmetry. So again, looking from the back, we look for trapezius, we look for supraspinatus, and we look for infraspinatus, and we look at the scapula for any obvious asymmetry. We also look at the deltoid bulk looking from the back, and you see the triceps on the back. At the same time, you can look at the spine as well. So after your look, it's feel. So I will show it on only one side. So I start my feel or palpation from sternoclavicular joint. You see a lot of elderly patients who will come with swelling and discomfort on this side. Those are typical for sternoclavicular arthrosis. Then you move on to the clavicle, look for any pain or any discomfort. Then you see this bony prominence on both sides. This is where the acromioclavicular joint is. So press it there and look at the face. If you see any change in expression as if he is in pain, then this may be due to acromioclavicular joint arthritis. Then again in the front, you need to feel for the coracoid. So coracoid is just underneath the lateral aspect of the clavicle, and again just press there. In the front, you also have biceps tendon. So you can feel for any discomfort or pain for bicipital or biceps tendon pathology. Coming from the front again, if you extend the shoulder, then what it does is it uncovers the anterior aspect of the shoulder, it brings it out of the acromion. So now the front part of the cuff is exposed. So if somebody has got supraspinatus impingement or cuff pathology, if you press here, they will show signs of discomfort or pain. So moving on to the side, you come to the lateral border of the acromion, and then you move on to the back, and we will start palpating the spine. So you go across the spine and feel for any discomfort or any pain. So now let's move on to the movements. So it's very easy if you ask patients to mimic your movement. So just tell your patient that I will, you know, try to do whatever I am trying to do. So that way it's very easy to patients to see what they are doing and they can follow what you are doing. But it can be very difficult, you know, extend or flex or rotation. So what I ask is, I stand in front of the patient and I tell them, can you do whatever I am doing? So this coming in the front, this is flexion. So put it down please. And if you turn it onto the side and put your hand back, then this. So this is extension. So this is flexion and this is extension. So let's now move on to abduction. So if you can do this for me please. So this is abduction. Put it down.
and adduction is in this plane. So this is adduction. So now we have left with external rotation and internal rotation. So I usually stand behind the patient when you are doing passive movement, but you can ask patient to do this. So this is external rotation with arms adducted, and then same way internal rotation. Can you do this? So when if patient is doing this, you want to see how far he can reach back. So usually you should do it one by one. So just take it off. So usually they can reach up to the inferior border of the scapula, which is around T7. This is normal. You have variation, but this is normal. Then they look for the other side. So this way you check internal rotation. So these are the movements that most of the clinicians will do. However, I would like to stress there is you need to check the same external rotation and internal rotation with arm abducted to 90 degree. So do this. So this is the starting position, and then this is external rotation and this is internal rotation. So you will see a lot of patients will have posterior capsular tightness. This is one pathology which is very underrated, tight posterior capsule. So those patients will have marked restriction of internal rotation. So do these movements in arm abducted to 90 degree as well. So now this is the general screening of a shoulder. So now let's move on to instability. So I will show you some tests that you should know if you are examining a patient with instability. So as you have noticed that majority of the shoulder examination can be done with patient standing up. So the first thing that you should do if you are doing or examining a patient with shoulder instability is to do a Beighton score. So Beighton score is a score for hyperlaxity, which has got a maximum score of 9. Anybody who scores more than 4 is said to be hyperlax or double jointed. So for that, how do we score it? So there are 9 points to it. So if you see this little finger, if somebody can bend it parallel to the forearm, then they get 1 point. Same if they are able to touch the thumb onto the forearm, they get 1 more point. So 1 and 1, 2, same. On the other side, 3 and bend, 4. The next thing is whether the joint is hyperextending more than 10 degrees. So if somebody can hyperextend more than 10 degrees, then you get one more score. So 4 in hands, this is 5, this is 6. Then comes the hyperextension of the knees. If somebody is hyperextending more than 10 degrees, then you get one more score. So that is 7 and 8. Last is if somebody is able to place the palm of the hand flat onto the ground without bending the knees, then that is an extra score. So that is 9. So if you score more than 4, then there is a very good chance that hyperlaxity may be one of the attributing factors for shoulder instability. So the first test when I do if I am examining a patient with instability is sulcus sign. Sulcus sign is nothing but if you push down the arm and you look if there is any formation of any divot or a sulcus here. If that is formed, that is a positive test. So if you push down and if you see a sulcus, that is a positive sign, and that can be one of the giveaway for an inferior instability. So the next test we are going to do is an apprehension test. So this is one test which I do both standing as well as lying down. So all you need is to create a position in which the shoulder dislocates. So this is usually abduction and external rotation. When you start doing this, you look at the patient's face. He will become apprehensive as if the shoulder is about to pop out. If you do this and if you see any signs of apprehension, that is a positive test suggestive of a possible anterior instability. So the next test that you should do if you are examining a patient with instability is load and shift test. So as the test suggests, it has got two components, loading and shifting. So during loading portion, all you want is if you feel that shoulder is either translated front or back, is to position it in the center. This is a normal patient, he has got no history of instability, so I don't need to do that. However, if you feel the head is slightly anterior posterior sublux, then relocate it in the center, that is the load component.
Then shift component, you shift first in the front. This guy is very muscular. And if you see whether how far the glenoid head is moving forward, whether it is translating slightly and then there is a fixed end point, or it is going to the edge, or it is coming completely out, you can grade it according to that. But if it goes in the front, that is suggestive of anterior instability. Same way, try to translate the head backwards to look for any posterior instability. So this is load and shift test. So after load and shift test, I get my patient to lie down, and then the examining shoulder is just on the edge of the couch, and I would do an apprehension test again. So in apprehension, if the arm is like this, just slowly abduct it and then externally rotate and look at the patient's face. If the patient looks apprehensive, then that is a positive apprehension test. If at this point, if I am externally rotating this much and the patient is apprehensive, then what you can do at the same point is a Jobe's relocation test. You can do it by pushing the head with a finger. Sometimes you struggle, so I usually use whole of my thenar eminence. And as you press it on the front, you will see that apprehension goes away, and you will be able to abduct it further without causing any apprehension. But just be very, very careful. You don't want to be dislocating somebody's shoulder in the clinic. So again, I would bring it back to the same position where we had apprehension, and then I am going to move my hand away. And again, you will see patient will become slightly apprehensive. So the last thing that I do when I am examining for instability is to check for again any posterior instability. So for posterior instability, I just flex the shoulder in the front. Elbow is also flexed up to the 90 degrees, and then you just try to give a posterior push. If you see any excessive translation, then that is a sign for lax posterior structures, which could be causing posterior instability. So next, move on to impingement, which is also a very common diagnosis and it's very easy to diagnose. So there are three things that I will expect you to know in impingement. So first is the painful arc. So let's see what is painful arc. So you ask your patients to slowly abduct and then bring the hand onto the top. And you can ask the patient, where do they feel the pain? And just let go. Typically, when the patient starts to abduct, they will start noticing pain somewhere around 60 degrees, and they will experience pain up to around 120 degrees. And after that, pain typically gets better. This is a typical range, but this range can vary from patient to patient. So don't get, it doesn't have to be always 60 to 120 degrees. As long as they are lifting it up and it is producing the symptoms and it gets better, then it is a positive test. So if somebody has got a painful arc and you are suspecting rotator cuff pathology or supraspinatus impingement, I would expect you to proceed on to the knees test. So knees test is just flexing the elbow, and this way you just slightly internally rotate the elbow as well and then try to lift it up. What it does is it brings the greater tuberosity and pinches the bursa between the acromion. And if the patient has got pain, then this is a positive test. So the second test that I would like you to know is a Hawkins-Kennedy test. This is also a test for impingement, and I find this test much more useful than knees test. So in this position, gradually flex the shoulder, and then what you want to do is to do some internal rotation. As you internally rotate, you are bringing the origin of tuberosity underneath the acromion, and once they pinch, it reproduces the pain. You can just do once or twice, don't do sudden movements, and if the patient shows any signs of pain, that is a positive Hawkins-Kennedy test. So let's move on to rotator cuff. Rotator cuff patients usually will be somewhere between 40 to 60 years of age. The typical symptoms will be pain across the side of the shoulder, inability to sleep on the shoulder, and it may also be associated with weakness in the hands, and they also complain of loss of movements. So now when you say rotator cuff, there are four muscles that form rotator cuff, that is supraspinatus, infraspinatus,
teres minor and subscapularis. So I will show you test for all these rotator cuff muscles one by one. So when you are examining a rotator cuff, always do a lag test that will suggest if there is a lag of that particular muscle, then that means the pathology is quite advanced and the tear may be very severe. So the first test that we like to do for supraspinatus is called an anti-CAM test. So two or three important things: that shoulder has to be abducted up to the 90 degrees. Secondly, shoulder has to be in around scapular plane, so it should be around 30 degrees in scapular plane, and thumbs down. And you will see lot of times even this position will reproduce pain and symptoms. So this is also, you can use it as a sign of an impingement as well. So first thing you do is, can the patient hold? If the patient can hold in this position, then that means that tear is not massive. And if he can't hold and arm drops, then that is a positive arm drop test that is suggestive of a significant or a massive cuff tear. So for lag test of supraspinatus will be to ask the patient to hold in this position. If they can hold it, then it's a negative lag test. Then secondly, in the same position, I would ask patient to pull up and I will pull it down. So this patient has got good strength. Make sure that the shoulder, the arms are internally rotated. This way you are trying to segregate supraspinatus from other muscles. So next group of rotator cuff muscle will include external rotators, that will include infraspinatus as well as teres minor. So both of them, they cause external rotators. So as with other rotator cuff muscle, the first thing I would like you to do is to do a lag test. So get your hand in this position and ask them to hold in this position. So get it outside, and if they can hold it in, if they can hold it in this position, that is a negative lag test. However, if it falls one side or other side, that is suggestive of significant tear of external rotators. So if once you have done the lag test, get the shoulder in this position, make sure that this is closed and the patient doesn't move the arm outside, and then you can ask them to move the hand away, and then you check the strength on both the sides. Any weakness is suggestive of involvement of external rotators. So the next test I am going to demonstrate you is what you call as a Hornblower sign, that is to segregate teres minor from infraspinatus. So Hornblower test is typically, if you ask the arm to abduct in the scapular plane, again when I say scapular plane, in around 30 degrees, and then keep the arm in this position. Okay, in this position, and then you ask the patient to push back. If they are able to push back, then that is a negative test. So if the patient is able to push back, that would suggest that the teres minor is intact. So Hornblower sign is a test for integrity of teres minor. Now the other way to do it is, certain clinicians will ask the patients to blow a horn. So if you blow a horn, you ask them to blow in this position. So if they can up the hand, abduct and keep it in this position, then that would suggest that the teres minor is intact. However, if there is a significant tear of teres minor, this arm will drop and they will blow horn in this position, and that would be a positive test. So the third group of muscle or rotator cuff muscle is subscapularis, which is responsible for internal rotation. So patients who can get their hand back, again start with the lag test. So lag test will be to ask them to keep it here and keep it away from the person. So keep it away from the back. If they are able to keep it away from the back, that is a negative lag test. If they can't, if it's falling back, then that's a positive test. You have tested for lag, and if it's negative or positive, ask the patient to push it away. So if the patient can push it away, then check the strength of subscapularis on both the sides and compare. If there is any weakness, then it is suggestive of subscapularis pathology. So once you start seeing shoulder patients, you will know that a lot of patients, they struggle to put their hand back, and it becomes very difficult to examine the subscapularis. So there is a modification of the test, or there is another test which is called Napoleon belly press test, which you can do in those cases. So ask the patient to put the hand on the belly, and then second thing, I would expect you to do a lag test. So the lag test for this will be to keep it in the front and see if the patient can hold it. If the patient can hold it in this position, then it's a negative test. And then you ask the patient to push it front. But make sure the patient is not leaning. This is another modification to test subscapularis. So your next group of patients will be patients who will complain of pain on the top of the shoulder, and that most likely will be due to acromioclavicular joint arthritis. Usually seen in elderly patients, but you will be surprised to know that you see it in young patients as well, and it can be very painful. Especially if young patients give history of going to gym and lifting heavy weight, that can cause osteolysis of lateral end of the clavicle, and that also reproduces pain in ACJ joint. So the test that I would like to know you to know about ACJ pathology is, first, of course, pain across when you palpate. Then if you do the painful arc in rotator cuff muscles, you will notice pain in initial of abduction. However, if the rotator cuff is intact and if there is a pathology of ACJ, you will notice it more past 90 degrees. So once you pass 90 degrees, majority of the force is going through acromioclavicular joint. So if you have got a pain after 90 degrees in painful arc, that is suggestive of acromioclavicular joint arthritis. Diagnosing ACJ pathology is very easy. Again, palpate there, look for patient's pain. If you are pressing here and it is reproducing his symptoms, then this is ACJ arthritis. Secondly, second test that I do is the cross arm adduction test. So you put the arm across and then try to push the arm adducted towards the opposite shoulder. This way it is putting pressure onto the ACJ and it is bringing both ends of the joint together, and it causes increased pain in acromioclavicular joint arthritis. But the key is, when you press, ask patient where is the pain. If he is complaining of pain here, it's a negative test. Test is positive only if he is complaining of pain on top of the shoulder. If somebody has got cross arm adduction test positive, that is suggestive of acromioclavicular joint pathology. So let's move on to the biceps tendinopathy. If somebody has got biceps tendinopathy, the patient usually gives pain and discomfort in front of the shoulder. So if the front of the shoulder is tender, then you should always be thinking of biceps pathology. So I'm going to demonstrate you two tests which will be positive in case patient has got a biceps pathology. Biceps has got two important functions. One is the flexion, the second is the supination. The first test I'm going to show you is a speech test. In speech test, the patient arm is extended, rotated, elbow extended, hands palm on the palm, and then you ask the patient to bring the hand forward. And if patient is complaining of pain in the front of the shoulder, that is a positive test. So the second test is Jurgensen test. In this position, we will see the elbow is flexed 90 degrees. Then we ask patient to forcibly supinate. And if it reproduces pain in front of the shoulder, that is a positive test for biceps tendonitis. So the next one of the important diagnosis in young patients is patients with slap tear. So the typical history of the patient with slap tear will be pain on throwing. So I am left-handed. So if somebody cannot throw, if I am throwing it fast like in this position and it is causing a sharp severe pain in the front or inside the shoulder, that is typical of a slap tear. So somebody who cannot throw in this position has got slap tear until proven otherwise. They will be able to do this, they will be able to throw underhand, but they can't throw in this position. If they can throw in this position, the chances of slap tear is very unlikely if the typical history is pain on throwing. So there is one test which is extremely important and which has got very high sensitivity for slap tear is O'Brien's test. So I am going to show you how to do an O'Brien's test. So the next test is what we call is an O'Brien's test, which is a good test for slap tear. So in O'Brien's test, some people get confused with Job's test. So I'll just make it very clear, that will make your life very easy. So what we want to do in O'Brien's test is, first flex the elbow up to 90 degrees with elbow extended and internally rotated, thumbs down. And the position for testing the supraspinatus is in this plane, 30 degrees in scapular plane. So if you do in this position, that is an empty canthus supraspinatus. Same position, if you adapt it around 10-15 degrees or 20 degrees inside, keep it in this position and then ask the patient to push it up. If they complain of pain on top of the shoulder or inside the shoulder, that is a positive O'Brien's test, which is suggestive of slap tear. So the last thing that I would like to cover is frozen shoulder. Frozen shoulder is a diagnosis of exclusion. If you have excluded everything and if your radiographs are normal, then you have got a patient with a frozen shoulder. So the typical presentation of frozen shoulder is pain. They can have quite severe pain and marked restriction of range of movement. And initial phase, there may be particularly loss of abduction, external rotation. In later stages, shoulder becomes really, really stiff. Now, how to diagnose a frozen shoulder? So the typical history will be severe pain in the shoulder associated with extreme loss of movements, asymmetric in movements. Third will be due to disuse. They can be wasting of deltoid, supraspinatus, infraspinatus, or actually all muscles across the shoulder. People struggle to differentiate frozen shoulder from an impingement. So now, one giveaway between frozen shoulder and impingement is, in impingement, when you are testing the movement, if the patient can only reach up to here actively, passively, you will be able to make the range of motion better. Say for example, if somebody has got impingement, he can only reach here, or if he has got a cuff pathology, he can only reach here. Passively, you should be able to get a full range of motion. However, in frozen shoulder, there is very little difference between active and passive movement. So whether you are doing it, patient is doing it actively, or you are doing it passively, you will see no improvement in their symptoms. So if you are examining a patient with the frozen shoulder, it is important. The first thing I look is asymmetricity of external rotation or not. So I stand behind the patients and then ask them to take it outside. So you will see if somebody has got frozen shoulder, this will go up to around 80-90 degree depending on person to person, and the other hand will only go up to here. And even if you try to increase the range of motion passively, you will struggle to do so. That is one giveaway. Then you check abduction, flexion, but some movement can happen at scapula. So if you really want to check movement of shoulder and rule out scapular movement for all other examination as well, you need to immobilize the scapula, and that will reflect the true range of motion at the inguinal joint. So if somebody has got frozen shoulder, there will be marked restriction or marked loss of range of motion, plus passively you won't be able to make that range of motion better. So viewers, this was a video demonstration of a comprehensive shoulder examination. I have tried to cover most important differential diagnosis that you will see in your clinic. I have not tried to do too many tests for one condition, but I have included the only test which I think will be most useful for you. I hope this video will help you in your clinical practice, and now you will feel more comfortable in examining shoulder patients. Do subscribe to our channel and do share this video.